If you've been following along with this series of videos, we've been showing you how to use DNA as a research tool in finding adoptive parents using the methodology that is shown on DNAadoption.org. Howdy, I'm Andy Lee with Family History Genetics, where we help you understand your DNA, climb your family tree, and write your ancestor's story along the way. Be sure to subscribe to our channel, and if you'd like to join our members section, we have access to even more training for those paid members. It's just $2.99 a month. Click on the join button below. In our search for adoptees, we've gone through the first two sets of steps from the DNAadoption.org. Now, the first section was about gathering information and taking the DNA test, and the second section was about actually using that to help build trees to find out how you might be able to find your biological parents. Be sure to check out their website, DNAadoption.org. There is lots of resources and more information about the process that can be very helpful for you in finding out who your biological parents are. And if you're not adopted, just remember that this process is not just for adoptees, but really for any time that you have a unknown ancestor and you want to use DNA in order to solve that question. So let's get started on the last phase of the steps in order to search for adoptive parents. And this is the contact, the reunion, and the afterward phase. Now, you've done a lot of work already in researching about people, in connecting trees. Hopefully, you've narrowed this down to one, maybe two or three individuals who might be that biological parent that you're looking for. The first thing that we want to do for this is we want to prepare for the contact. And by preparing for the contact is we want to gather as much possible information as we can. In other words, we don't want to start with a list of 20 or 30 people and have to contact all of them. We want to narrow that list down as much as possible. Now, this can be done through our traditional genealogy research, in identifying people who weren't in the right place at the right time, as well as through contacting different groups and finding resources that can help us where we may not already have some knowledge for the records that we're looking at. In a lot of cases, when I have done this in helping adoptees, after we've narrowed it down to a list, I will then go and I will create as much of a family history tree of that person as I can, just using the resources available online, to see if there's any information that would discount this potential match as being where it is. In some cases, I found that. In some cases, what I've actually found is that even though I'd isolated it down to this one family, when I looked just a little bit further after building out their tree, oh, it wasn't the father, you know, a couple of generations back, it was actually the mother's family that it was related through, and that's the side I had to go through. So instead of having to contact all the people on the father's side, I was able to contact the correct people on the mother's side. The other thing with preparing for your contact is you want to be talking with others who have gone through this. Now, we had Larry Johns on this program, and he talked for about an hour about not just his one experience, but two experiences of finding out that, hey, his person who raised him was not his biological father, and then the new biological father turned out wasn't his biological father either. He's also helped several adoptees go through this process because it is something that is personal for each one, and so the emotions that you're going to feel are going to be different. But I think it's important to go and join some of these DNA adoption groups on Facebook or elsewhere in order to get as much information as possible. There have been lots of people who have gone through this, and there are lots of different ways that it has happened. So there's not one little cookie cutter approach. But I think talking with each of these different individuals and hearing about their experiences will help prepare you for what you're going to be going through next. So go and take a look online and join the DNA adoption online groups and ask people about contacting and what they did, how they did that, and what they need to be prepared for. Also on the DNAadoption.org website, there is some resources for you to help you out. So check those out as well. The one thing that is emphasized more than anything else in this stage is don't rush this. This is probably a, you know, where the pinnacle of your emotions are. You've had this search and you found it and you want to just have this confirmed. You want to make sure you're taking all the right steps so that you don't make a situation worse than what it was. Now, this may be really difficult for people who don't know who their biological parents are, who have been searching and wanting to know for years or decades. But this is a time where it would be good to take a step back and also get some other people's opinions who have gone through this before, because this is not just an emotional time for you, but this can be a very emotional time for that biological family who may or may not have known about your existence. And then the next step then is, after you've done this preparation, after you've taken the time, is the one really that we've been waiting for, is making this initial contact. Now, you can make this contact in various ways. You can write a letter, you can write an email, you can make a phone call. You could even make an in-person visit. But with each one of these, you want to think about and make sure you're making the right one for that situation, which is really part of this step 9 that we just talked about. On the DNA Adoption website, there is a list of resources about making contact. So for instance, you can actually go to any of these links and get some more information from people who have been counselors who have helped this, or people who have been adoptees who have gone through this, and talk about the things to do when you're making contact, how to actually have that conversation. It's something that you may want to role play with somebody beforehand so that you feel comfortable in making that contact or asking for some more information. And some people may ask whether they should be making the contact themselves or whether they should have somebody else make the contact. And in the research I've done, I've heard it talked about both ways. In cases that I've been involved with, I've also had it done both ways. In some cases where there was an adoptee that was contacting me because of a close relationship in our family, I knew from who they were talking about and then looking at the DNA where that relationship was. And so they were contacting me first to try to get some information about contacting these other people. I then discreetly talked to some other family members about, you know, who this could be particularly and whether or not they would be open to contact. And so that was a way to help facilitate some of that information, but you may not always have that. So again, go back to step 9, look at the preparing, and be ready for this contact phase and know what you're getting into with this contact. Make sure you understand that your emotions may not be the same as the other person's emotions that you're going to be contacting. The third step of this group of four, and the 11th step overall, is the reunion phase. Now, this is where you're actually going to meet your biological parents, or you're going to meet a relative of this ancestor that you don't know, that you hadn't found before. This can be a happy time. This can be a sad time. This can be a very confusing time. There can be any number of emotions that are going on. Now, if you've done the contact correctly, then hopefully that will lead to a reunion. But that reunion doesn't necessarily mean that you're going to have the type of relationship that you want. One thing that everybody needs to recognize is that you're not entitled to have a relationship with anybody. You may want that, but they may not want that. That's going to be something that is difficult probably for you. And so this reunion is something that you need to prepare for. And it can take as much time or as little time as you need. And again, I would urge you to go back to the website, the DNA Adoption website, and the DNA online support groups, the adoption online support groups, to talk with others about this reunion, what you should do and how it should be, where it should be, anything like that. you may find that this is actually, you know, a really joyful occasion and that there are no problems. But you should be prepared in case everybody is not having the same emotions as you. Some family members may not accept this the same way that other family members are going to accept this. And so it's important that you're thinking about this beforehand and you're preparing yourself for the different range of emotions that you're going to be seeing out of people. Now, the final step of this is the afterward phrase. What happens after you've had this reunion, after you've made a connection? Where do you go from here? And as with all of these steps really on this part, is most of these deal with emotions and deal with how you're feeling and how the other person is feeling and what you want to do. It's not always going to be one way or another. Every instance where an adoptee is finding their biological parents is going to be different. Some people are going to accept this and they're going to want to have an ongoing relationship with that new family. Others may be satisfied with just having met, and that's all they want. They don't want anything else. And these involve, again, multiple people. You may want something, but the other person may not want it. And so afterwards, you need to recognize what it is that you want going forward, but also deal with what they want going forward. Again, this is where the DNA adoption online groups are going to be helpful, because you're going to be able to have support from others who have gone through this and also seen all the different ways that people can react. Now, while I'm not adopted myself, I've had the pleasure of working with several people who have been or who didn't realize that a biological parent wasn't their one who raised them. I've seen lots of different ways that this has happened, both happy and sad, where some people want to have this connection and others don't want to have this connection. So reach out to your support groups, reach out to the online groups at DNA Adoption. Feel free to email them if you have questions and you want to get some more help in understanding what's going on. You may have lots of time to process this. You may not have much time to process this. But searching for and finding your biological parents can be a fun and a rewarding process just in the search for it. Recognize that this last part may actually take the longest amount of time. I actually have somebody that I've been working with for just a little over a year, where we know his father is one of three people. And over that time, he's been processing that. And he has not yet decided that he wants to make contact yet. And so even though the research part and the gathering of information part actually happened rather rapidly, this last stage of these four steps of making contact and the reunion has taken quite a long time. And he may decide in the end that he doesn't want to continue with it. That is his decision. If you have questions about how DNA can help you with your adoption search, then put it in the comments below. Make sure you check out the DNAadoption.org website. There's a link in the description below and on each of these videos. I hope that you have success in your search in finding what you are looking for.